1, 2, 3. Hello, I'm Abram Hindle. Welcome to this Compute 301 lecture from the Department of Computing Science at the University of Alberta in Edmonton, Alberta, Canada. We'll be talking about testing, and this is relevant to the Compute 301 course. My email is abramhindle@ualberta.ca, and my webpage is softwareprocess.es. We're going to be talking about testing software. These slides were originally by Ken Wong, and some images and some stuff in the slides has been reproduced as allowed under the Copyright Act. So, we're talking about testing. What is the fundamental goal of testing? Basically, we want to see in the abstract if program P obeys specification S. So P, what is it? Is it your program? Is it a part of your program? Is it a function? Is it one line? And what's the specification S? Is that a requirement? What is that? So consider that maybe P is code you care about, and S is things that the code is supposed to do that's been in the specification. So P, your program, can be pretty broad. It can produce lots of different results. It can have a huge number of states. It can have a huge number of inputs and outputs. Internally, from start to end, it can have a huge number of states. And if you wanted to test every aspect of P, you might not be able to do it. There might be too many paths through your program, so it might not be possible to test every path. Furthermore, what we can do to reason about this is we can abstract states into groups, and then maybe by testing that group, we can cover entire ranges of states that could be tested. So really what we want to know is, given program P, given S, how can we test it, and how can we avoid testing it forever? We eventually have to stop sometime. So we have multiple techniques. We can abstract the states. We can sample the states. So we could view them in groups and then show for groups that it's done. We could sample the states. We could choose random states, and we could test on them. Alternatively, we can do both. So abstraction in software usually refers to proof or static analysis. Basically, we check the model for P for some specific S. Statically typed programming languages do this. They check the types to make sure that all the types make sense such that they meet the specification of the types working together. You don't specify any program that's got broken types or inconsistent types, because that violates S. And S in that case, for static type checking, is that the types make sense that you've specified. The problem is that this technique is not always correct. It's oftentimes very pessimistic. In many cases, your program will run just fine without you declaring the types. In many cases, your program will run just fine if you switch a signed int for an unsigned int. In many cases, your program will run just fine if you use 4 bytes for a character or 1 byte for a character. So what we want to do is we want to basically check what we care about is that using this abstraction method, P might be faulty. We may report P is faulty when P is correct. When we do sampling, we're relying on statistical techniques. We're usually running the program. We're testing and profiling it. We're checking stuff randomly, or we're checking paths. And these techniques are usually optimistically inaccurate. They may report that your program P is correct when P is in fact faulty, because the test didn't cover test cases which were faulty but you did not test them. Furthermore, testing might not generalize to how the program is actually used. The test might be naive about the real world use of the program, and thus the samples, the tests, they might not generalize. They might not be applicable. So, abstraction is things like static analysis and type systems. Sampling is things like choosing random tests, writing tests, having a set of tests, profiling software, measuring it, but not necessarily being able to measure all executions of it. So one method of testing is state-based testing. To do state-based testing, you set the software into a known state. For instance, you could initialize variables, you could open up the database connection, you could set the software into a state that simulates where the user might be. Then, once you're in that state, you trigger transitions to cause state changes. Basically, you call methods, you change the variables, and then once those state changes have occurred, you verify that the actual arrived state is the state that you expected. You basically check to see if the values and the variables meet expectations. So an example of this would be, I want to make sure that when I update a database, the value is updated. So first I get a connection to the database, and then I insert a value into that database with a set ID and other associated values. Then I run update. I trigger a state change. I tell it to update that row with that ID with my new variables. Then I tell it to select that row again, get it out from the database, and then I verify that for every variable I changed, that it was changed in the database. And that would be an example of state-based testing. And that's the common method of testing used by JUnit and other frameworks. So they've got a setup, they've got a trigger state change, and they got a verification. Then sometimes they got to tear down to clean up what they set up. So let's talk about software defects. Software defects can be described using many terms. For instance, human errors can lead to faults in work products, which may cause failures when running the software. So an error is something I make. It can lead to a deficiency, which can be a fault in the work that I produce. This fault can induce failure. So an error could be that I assume that the variable is not null. This leads to a fault where there's an assumption and the variable is assumed to be not null, so when we call a method on it, it causes a failure. We can try to search for these faults through testing, reviews, proof, model checking, code analysis, any kind of method like that. While a fault and its failure might be considered a bug, we should watch out because the term bug implies an actual bug, which was one of the earlier bugs, wandered into the code. Furthermore, it isn't very specific. If I make an error in my programming, then that is a fault in the work, if I make a mental error. But what if I didn't make a mental error and it still led to a failure? So you got to consider these different cases: errors, faults, failures. An example of a failure. In 1990, AT&T on the West Coast, or on the East Coast, sorry, they had 114 of their switching nodes, their long distance system crash. This outage halted long distance communications for 9 hours. 70 million calls were made during those 9 hours, and those calls were not completed. The reason why this failure occurred was that if a node crashes, it tells its neighbors that it's down, so it tells it to reroute traffic around it. The problem was that there was a bug handling this message. Basically, by handling that error message, it caused that node to crash as well. So it propagated a wave of crashes as each machine tried to propagate the information that it had crashed, whereas the machines receiving the crash also crashed because they had faulty code. The root cause was that they had this kind of code here. They had a do while loop, they were looping, they had a switch statement, they had a case in the switch statement, and then inside this case they ran break. This break meant the code was left in an inconsistent inconsistent state. Code after here would not be run, and it caused a crash. This small change of adding a break was made without retesting. So they just made this small change. They didn't think they had to retest. They didn't want to spend money on retesting. They committed it. And then what happened was when it got hit, it caused a crash. It caused inconsistent state, which killed a bunch of nodes. So we have failures, and failures are caused by human error, because the human error was both in the process, they ignored their process here, and also they reasoned incorrectly about their code. So there's different kinds of defects, and there's sort of classes of defects. So one class is actual behavior differing from expected behavior. So the example might be logarithmic. The code logic does not produce the proper output. So your algorithm could be incorrect. Another example would be you provide too much data. The data structure unexpectedly filled to capacity and produce a different behavior because it didn't say operate on everything. It got stuck. Alternatively, different behavior from expected would be the performance wasn't met. So maybe the system got swamped with requests and stopped responding to them. So it didn't behave as expected, and it might have violated a service level agreement that was agreed upon. A service level agreement could say, we should have 99.9% availability to your software at all times, meaning that you're only allowed to be down 0.01% of a year, which isn't that long. That's less than one day. Furthermore, the accuracy could be wrong. For instance, your calculated result could have lost information or could have been inaccurate as is being calculated, and thus it lost its accuracy. There's also timing issues. So you would be really annoyed if the bank tried to deposit two of your checks at once and only one of the checks got deposited because the bank system didn't realize two operations were occurring to your account and it ignored one of the checks. This would be considered a race condition. So we've got different kinds of defects. We got failures, we got errors. We don't really want to call them bugs. We've got different ways of testing. So why do we bother to test? Well, one of the goals is verification. We want to ensure that the requirements are satisfied. Furthermore, we want to confirm that the program goes through normal behavior, but we also want to give it problems that could make it exhibit problematic behavior. By making the program refute these problems, we show that the program is correct and we gain confidence in the program. We can't test for everything in many cases, but we can oftentimes trust or gain confidence in the ability of the program to produce the correct result. If we give it a problem which it should be able to solve and it solves it, that adds confidence to us. Sometimes you want to establish due diligence. You want to prove that you tried hard to make sure that your product acted responsibly and that you have the test cases necessary to show that you shouldn't be liable because you've already covered that case. Another reason is to avoid regression. Regression means to go back, to turn back the clock, to go backwards. So what you want to do is you want to avoid previous problems from reoccurring. So if you have an automated test suite and you put your problems to refute into that test suite, then you can run them again to see if that problem occurs. So regression testing is pretty important. It's very common. If a product comes with a benchmark, you can consider that a regression test. For instance, the MySQL database system has optional regression tests, benchmarks that you can run to prove that the new version of MySQL is equivalent to the prior version of MySQL, given the set of tasks that they provide. This allows them to tell if a change that they have made impacts the performance of the system. Other kinds of regression testing include testing things that they have fixed in order to make sure they stay fixed. Basically, the goal of regression testing is to avoid breaking things that should work. You want to basically collect these fixes and these tests in and be able to rerun these tests in automated test cases that give you feedback that you haven't broken things, and you have not rebroken things that you already broke. A regression test is often good after you make a change. It will give you feedback if you have changed something like performance, or the system has become somehow unfixed, or an old defect became unfixed. You could consider a real world example where the Mozilla browser, it repeatedly had URL parsing problems that would cause exposure of files on your computer in the URL parser. This also happened to Internet Explorer. Both of the browsers could have learned from each other, but instead they didn't, and they both repeated the same kind of defect. Had they noticed that one had this bug and that they should write a test for their browser, they might have noticed that they actually created a bug. So, we're not really talking too much about proof here, we're more so talking about testing. The issue with testing is it's very limited. So, a program cannot be tested completely, usually because there are too many inputs and too many path combinations to cover. This means that given a program, the range of inputs is quite broad, and thus also the range of paths through the program is quite broad, so oftentimes it's infeasible to search through the entire program. So consider a program where we've got a function, and that function takes in an integer parameter, which we'll call t. Inside of that function, we check to see if t is equal to 1,000,000,006. If it's equal to 1,000,000,006, we'll return true. If it's not equal to 1,000,000,006, we'll return false. In order to completely test this program, we would have to walk through all of the inputs, all the 4 billion possible inputs, and make sure that only for one input does it actually answer true. 4 billion inputs might be feasible on a modern computer if this task is simple, but if the task is complex, it would take too long. So, we can't always completely test programs, even naively simple programs. Furthermore, testing cannot find all defects. Testing cannot show their absence. So this is the science problem. They can only show their presence. They can only prove that a defect does exist. They can't prove that it doesn't exist. Basically, you can only prove that this code runs and it produces the output. You don't prove anything else by writing a test. But what you do gain is confidence. You gain confidence that your program is working and it's adhering to the standards you set out. Furthermore, testing can be very challenging. It's expensive and frustrating. And the test code could add its own defects, or the test code could be buggy and could even induce you to add defects trying to adhere to the test code. So you have to watch out. Testing can be expensive and frustrating in the cases where there's lots of inputs, the inputs are complicated, or in a probabilistic setting. For instance, if you are making a white noise generator that generates white noise, and it produces different white noise every single time you run it, you're going to have to use expensive testing techniques that will tell you how confident they are that you actually produce white noise or not. Now, there are different methodologies of testing. One methodology is black box testing. Black box testing is where you're systematic, but you don't know the internal code. It's like you were given a black box, it takes inputs, it produces outputs. You don't know what's going on inside, so you go and try to feel it out and try to test to understand it. You test to explore it. So, imagine we have a function, okay? And the function, given these two parameters, produces this result. We assume that this function is probably producing a sum. So we try 2 and 3. It produces 5. That's a simple test. Then we decide, well, let's see if it does larger values. We go 99 plus 99, or 99, 99 the parameters. We get 198 as the result. It looks like it's plus. Does it work on negative numbers? What if it only accepted positive numbers? So we test the big number and the negative number, and we get a large positive plus negative. Here we've got 99 plus 16. We get 115, so it can add a large positive with a smaller positive. We can test large negative numbers. We can do the opposite of this test, but negatively. We can see if it cancels out a large positive plus a large negative. This one is actually pretty important because some numbers on the computer, they won't have a negative. So in the integers, I think the negative numbers are one larger than the positive numbers. So the largest positive plus the largest negative will be a different result. So this is an example of black box testing. We sort of assume what's going on inside. The function has a name, but we want to test the function by giving it different inputs. If at any point it didn't answer the right result, we'd have to figure out why, or produce more test cases to explore that result. Now, look at these test cases. Consider this: avoid redundant tests. It's too easy to add meaningless extra tests. So consider, is this one and this one, are they important, or were they already covered? Did this test already cover this one and this one, or did this test cover this one and this one, or did this test cover this one and this one? Which one of these are redundant? Do we need to test these two? Do we need to test these two? Does it really matter? Okay, so we want to avoid redundant tests, but we also can look for tests that do almost the same work. So think about this. Why wouldn't we go minus 98 and minus 98 if we've done minus 99 minus 99? We probably wouldn't, because we assume that these two big numbers that are very close together would be equivalent to each other in terms of testing. So what we mean by an equivalence class is a test is that if you have an equivalence class, if you test one thing inside the equivalence class, it's pretty well the same as checking everything else in the equivalence class. One pass in that class means that everything in that class is passed. So if a test inside the class will catch a defect, then other tests probably will show the defect as well. If it does not catch a defect, it probably is not defective. So you'll need to keep a few tests in each equivalence class as representatives. Now, we're not talking about Java classes. We're talking about mathematical classes, basically equivalence classes. Groups of inputs that should have the same or similar answer and that should operate the same code, and thus if we test one of them, we pretty well test them all. Here's an example. We have three equivalence classes here, right? And in each one of these, we've got test cases. We can by knowing these equivalence classes, we can reduce the amount of testing from every element to just three elements by simply choosing one element from each test case. If we didn't have these equivalence classes, we weren't sure about it, we'd have to test each and every element here to have any kind of confidence that we made it anywhere. We'd do more tests than the three tests. We'd be doing redundant effort, because according to our equivalence classes, these are pretty well the same thing. So, black box testing can be used in an exploratory manner. You can try to use it to figure out if what's actually inside, or also the limitations of it. So you might consider 0, 0, 0. You want to get 0 back. Here we got 0, 23. We get 0 plus positive.
We see if the zero cancels anything out. Nope. We give it, we can start feeling out the size of the inputs. Can we just give it bytes? It works on bytes. Can it deal with signed? Yeah, it works there. We can also max out the integers. And what we might find is that this overflows and we don't get an answer that we like. Alternatively, with this one, we can see that this one is minus one, so we know it can do this. And in this case, that minus that, it can't represent it. So perhaps this is done with signed integers, and it can't represent anything bigger than positive 2 billion and negative 2 billion. So black box testing is pretty useful when you sort of have ad hoc user fields. Like, imagine this function is on a web page, and you start inputting these values, 4 over 3 and 2, $2 and $2, plus 5 and 3. Can it add all of these things together? Will it add lowercase l and 1? Will it add 0? Will it add O and 0? Will it operate a white space? Can decimal numbers be used? Can ASCII characters be used? You probably want to ensure that in all of these cases, it produces no result or gives an error. But if any of these cases work, that's sort of a concern. It concerns something else is going on with the test case. So here's an example test case. So you can explore user interfaces. So if you're editing with delete, backspace, user keys, cursor keys, can you do that? What happens when you press F1? What happens to the system then? Does it produce help? Does it do what you want it to do? Does escape get you out of a bind? What about control characters? You might have bugs in terms of timing. If you type too fast, your machine might not be able to keep up, or your software might not be able to keep up even when it should. You can ensure that keys work as they're expected. So, if you discover a test in software, or if you discover a bug in software, if you discover a failure in software, what you can do is you can rely on a defect tracker. A defect tracker allows you to basically report a bug. So I'll give you an example of a defect tracker. So this is an example of a defect tracker. This is the Google Android defect tracker. Here we've got an issue ID, we've got a description, and we've got a report. This report isn't really useful, doesn't really say much, but it says email setup. Nonetheless, it's considered obsolete. It was closed. They're not sure what it's about. We can look for other issues here. So we could say open keyboard issues. And we could see that there's defects. So this person responds that they're having a problem with disabling auto-correction, and it causes a number format exception when they disable it. So they're reporting a bug, they're telling you what they use, and they're basically documenting the bug. People hope that it gets dealt with. So we can go all issues, we can search for keyboard, we can look for, these are all relatively new bugs, there's even duplicate bugs. So they say this is a duplicate of this issue, we've dealt with it. And there's oftentimes discussions related to bugs, as well as screenshots and other things like that. Bugs eventually, these issues get addressed and eventually dealt with by developers, whether or not they actually fix it or they delegate responsibility. So each of these bugs has ID, classification, description. And for each of the reported bugs, you can tell its status. Is it open or closed? Is it done? Was it resolved? And who was involved? So if you do find errors, you can always report them. And oftentimes you find them via black box testing. So we're back to testing. We're talking about test strategies. There's various ways to go through and test a system. One is the Big Bang strategy. This is you're done the system.
it's put together, and you want to thoroughly test the whole system. The pro of this approach is that when the project is almost finished, you only have to test. The con is that you've done so much work that it'll be hard to pinpoint the cause of failure. So if you have a serious problem that appears when you start testing, it's very expensive. Alternatively, if you had a quality process, it was being built very carefully, it was well designed, perhaps you'll get away with minimal testing and you won't spend a lot of time on it. But it is sort of a dangerous strategy because you're really just hoping that you don't have to do a lot of testing. But the second you find a failure, you're in deep trouble because you have to write more tests to figure out where that failure is. Another strategy is the top-down incremental strategy. This is where you start at the highest level modules and you test them. You basically provide stubs for the lower level functionality that's not yet implemented, and basically you have higher level modules that are basically the test drivers. So you implement tests for the highest level modules first. This would be like your APIs, the stuff that the users might interact with, the interface to the model, and then once you do that, you start testing the lower level ones. The bottom-up strategy is a different strategy of unit of testing. It usually starts with unit tests. You write test drivers, and then you implement the lowest level modules first, and you implement and test them first, and then you build up. So in this case, you might test every method as you write it. In this case, you might test every module as you write it and then add method test case later. So oftentimes people will mix these two strategies, top-down and bottom-up. The benefit of top-down is you probably do less testing work. The benefit of bottom-up is that you are relying on the correctness of the lower layers to make the higher levels correct, to ensure correctness of the higher level layers. So, we're talking about testing, we're talking about test strategies. It's all pretty abstract. Furthermore, we have to wonder what is a good test. A good test has a good error message. But one way of testing, one good method of testing is to test every error message that the program produces. Every single time there's a possibility of an error, you should test that. And you should test that because error handling code tends to run less. It tends to be weaker, and oftentimes the scenarios don't always happen. Other testing techniques are to test under different configurations. Developers tend to be biased towards their own computer, and they don't test on other machines. So they miss out on deployment issues, like maybe they didn't package the appropriate library, maybe they're making too many assumptions about the power of the performance of the end user's computer. So different configurations help as well. They are also good as smoke tests, basically seeing if something is broken. All right, in the next video, I will talk about design for testing. In this video, I covered possibly what are good test cases, some testing strategies from Big Bang to top down to bottom up. We covered what defect tracking is, what black box testing is, equivalence classes, the limits of testing, how it can't necessarily find everything, what regression testing is, why we want to test, what kinds of defects we could have, algorithmic, overloaded, performance, accuracy, things like that. The effect of faults. This cost AT&T lots of money. What software defects are. The difference between how tests normally work, where we set them up, where we trigger transitions and we verify what happened, then maybe tear them down. We talked about sampling, where we have tests and profiles. We talked about abstraction, where we do model checking or static analysis. We talked about the abstract aspect of testing where we really just want to see if program P obeys specification S. All right. So in the next video, we'll talk more about testing and testing.